With Russia just across the Bering Sea, it's no wonder Alaska is home to 9 military bases, largely built during the Cold War. But not all threats come from overseas. Some may be visiting from other worlds.
My name's Al Rhodes. My family and I had a scary experience leaving out of Anchorage, Alaska, on our way to a new duty station as we served in the United States Air Force. My job in the military was a radar operator. That's where I met my wife. She worked in the radar station also.
My name is Ginger Rhodes. We became friends first, and 3 years later, we were married in 1980.
My wife and I were both stationed at Elmendorf Air Force Base, Alaska.
Located in Anchorage, Elmendorf's primary mission is to defend America's northernmost border from airborne attack.
I was responsible for early warning and identification section.
I identified aircraft coming into the airspace and leaving the airspace.
It's high-pressure work, assigned only to the most skilled and disciplined airmen.
You're staring at a radar screen, and blips come over.
A blip was an aircraft, and so you track the aircraft that way.
You had to identify these guys as either friendly, unknown, hostile, and you had 2 minutes to do that.
After years studying those blips, there are very few aircraft Alton and Ginger can't recognize.
Part of my job is to understand what these aircrafts are, know some of the capabilities of the aircraft.
I could identify almost any aircraft.
Alton and Ginger were so good, they were transferred to an Air Force base in Florida that needed help with its radar station.
We bought a brand new Dodge Ram van.
Within about 3 weeks of buying that van, we were driving to Florida.
They had an epic journey ahead of them. Thousands of miles in 2 weeks. Their first leg took them northeast toward the Canadian border.
Nothing unusual about the day. We just rode, talked on a normal routine drive.
That night, maybe 7:30, my son and my daughter was sleeping in the back of the van. My wife was sitting up front with me. We were maybe 20 miles to Tok Junction. All the power went out of our van. The lights went off. The engine shut down.
We had no idea why.
And I turned the key switch, and no response from the vehicle. We did pull off the road.
And then it happened.
Flashing lights over the van from nowhere.
You couldn't see what it was. You could only see lights.
This object, whatever it is, it's darting back and forth on either side of the road, and it's still flashing these lights.
Alton and Ginger were dumbstruck, trying to make sense of what they were seeing.
It would be over the van 1 minute, and the next minute you look, and it's like hundreds of miles away. And I mean, in the blink of an eye, it was gone. And that fast, it would be right back over you again.
This thing could zip. I'd never seen anything like that. It's like taking a laser pointer and just moving it on the wall, zip it from one side to the other. This thing, I don't know what the hell it was. And I was responsible for identifying aircraft.
Adding to the couple's terror, they seemed to be trapped in the UFO's wake.
Each time this thing was over the top of our van, man, you could feel that power. You could feel the power. That van just rocked.
My dad used to put the car under a railroad trestle when the train was going over, and that's what it sounded like boom. And my first instinct was to freak up.
I was afraid for my life. I remember my wife telling me not to leave the vehicle.
And I was like, no, honey, please, please don't get out the van, because I didn't want something to happen to you.
But we were just sitting there, just sitting ducks. And by then, I think my son was crying, so I had to do something. I grabbed a pair of pliers from my toolbox and raised the hood of the van, and I touched the pliers to both poles on the battery. no spark. And this time my wife is screaming for me to get back in the van. I did get back in the van, and we're sitting there. No power, no lights.
And this thing came back over again, and the van was just shaking.
After sitting there for maybe 10, 15 minutes, this thing finally left. And all of our power came back on the van. I tried the key, and it cranked with a strong battery. And we drove to the hotel. And I remember asking the lady behind the counter when we checked into the hotel, has anyone ever reported anything like a UFO? And she laughed and said no.
But Alton and Ginger weren't laughing along, especially when they realized they'd lost hours of time. Even with their 15-minute delay, they should have hit Toke Junction by 9 p.m.
It was around 11-ish when we checked into the hotel. I can't explain any of it, but I have no idea, no recollection.
Missing time is a phenomenon often connected to UFO sightings and abductions. And much to the couple's horror, the after effects of their encounter were just getting started.
After we arrived at the hotel, I started to get sick. I'm the only one that got out of the car, I'm the only one that got sick that night.
The next thing I hear is a loud boom. And it's come from the bathroom, so I get out of bed and I run in there, and he had, like, fainted into the tub.
And I was sick like that for a few days.
Yeah, I had to drive for the next 2 days. He was that sick.
When we finally arrived at our next duty station, my commander was concerned about me. He thought that maybe I was under a lot of stress, but if you were part of the government, and I was, something you didn't talk about, unless you want to bring your career to a screeching halt.
Alton simply had too much to lose.
I joined the Air Force in 1974. I had 14 years in service at the time, 6 years to go before I retired. Those are the things that I was up against. Probably everyone has had an encounter is up against. You were probably be sent to the psychiatrist within an hour of telling your story. As a matter of fact, if someone else had told me the story that I'm telling you, I probably would have laughed at it, and I probably would have been one of those people guilty that the person's got to be out of their mind, because that kind of stuff don't happen.
I don't think Alton and I even talked about it until after he retired. It was just that taboo.
Telling their story may ease Alton and Ginger's minds, but what they experienced on the road to Toke Junction still haunts them to this day.
I had no reason to believe in UFOs, and it was nothing I even thought about until that night, leaving out of Anchorage, Alaska. Not only did I get sick that night, I kept fainting for years to come, probably about at least every 60 days to 90 days. It's never stopped. I've probably gone out to the hospital more than 8 times for that problem. 8 times. They can't find anything wrong. Blood pressure normal. All the stats pretty much where they're supposed to be. I could sit here and next instant I could be laying on the floor. They have never been able to give me an answer on why.
Yeah, it was something that night that got him. I believe it was radiation poisoning.
I don't have any other explanation for it.
Now living in Texas, the couple hopes that their candor will help more airmen come clean about what they witnessed in the skies over Alaska.
After that night, I emphatically believe in UFOs. There's no other explanation.
Never had anything that interesting happen to me since then, and before then. It made a belief out of me.
It's a life changer, it really is. I don't think you ever think the same again when something like that happens to you. And you're always looking in the sky, always looking for something.